Okay, so thanks a lot for having me. In this session, I will try to share an example on how to apply some source code management patterns to the management of Kubernetes clusters. I'm Giovanni. I work as a customer engineer at Google Cloud, specializing on app modernization. I will try to describe a way of moving from an imperative way of managing Kubernetes clusters, where you typically apply commands to Kubernetes API server through kubectl or any other tool, and this configuration is not repeatable because it doesn't live anywhere besides the clusters, to a declarative way of doing this. No? So I think this is already discussed in these days. So the cluster configuration is inside a central Git repository, and all the clusters sync with this central configuration and apply and enforce what is defined centrally. On Google Cloud, one of the ways of accomplishing this is the use of Anthos Config Management that has three components: Config Sync, Policy Controller, and Config Connector. I will describe more Config Sync in this talk. Anthos Config Management is part of Anthos, the Google application modernization platform that has Kubernetes as its foundation. It has other tools that I will not describe here today, and then extends the possibility of having a Google-provided Kubernetes platform outside and beyond Google Cloud. So also inside the enterprise data center on in other clouds. And all these environments can be managed with Anthos Config Management. Also, what we call attached clusters. So clusters that are not GK clusters, that are not provided by Google, clusters like Amazon EKS, Azure Kubernetes Service, OpenShift, that can be onboarded with Anthos and managed with these tools included Anthos Config Management. Config Sync, as I was saying, what is? It's an operator running on the clusters that continuously sync with a central Git repository, any repository that is Git compliant, and keep the clusters configuration, clusters of different types, all the types I mentioned before, and in wherever they are, with this central defined configuration, continuously enforcing that and avoiding that any local drift can happen. So if a local drift happens, this is avoided. As we said at the beginning, this allows you to apply some of the source code management approach to cluster management. For example, every configuration, it's a commit, it's a commit ID. So in case something goes wrong, you can always roll back to a configuration that you know to work well. Let's try to see some of these in actions. I'm doing this for the first time from a Windows PC. I'm not used to that. Please, demo gods, be with me. Here you can see that I have two clusters in my GCP console. One is a GK cluster living on GCP, and another one is an EKS cluster, so an external cluster, an Amazon EKS cluster registered to run here. Here you can see the EKS cluster also from the EKS console. And both these two clusters have been configured to use Anthos Config Management. So they are configured to synchronize their configuration with a Git repository that is this one. This is just an example, is a repository living in my personal GitHub account. Okay, that I have here, but let's see the local version of this repository. At the moment, this is almost empty. An interesting directory is the namespace directory. I will try to populate this with some configuration and then describe what it does. Let's copy some manifest there. Okay. As you can see, inside this namespace configuration, I have two folders, two other directories, application one and application two. If when you create a folder inside the namespace folder, and if this folder contains, as you see here, a resource manifest defining a namespace, this triggers the creation of a namespace on the managed cluster. And all the resource manifests that are inside the folder identify the namespace, triggers the creation of specific resources inside that namespace. So we have this resource manifest triggering the creation of this application one namespace, and we have this role binding, actually binding a user. Is Leonardo at agilework.info is a fantasy character. I'm using Renaissance characters here, bound to the admin cluster role. So basically, this will allow this user to deploy application in this specific namespace, have admin privileges in this specific namespace. In the reality, probably you will bound this to a service account running a continuous delivery deployment of applications. But this is just to show how to implement role-based access control from the central repository for each namespace. I have an application to folder with a similar structure, creating a second namespace for the application with another role binding for another user. This is for each namespace. And on top of that, if I want to apply some configuration and resources to all the namespaces contained in this folder, I can create a resource manifest in the parent folder. So in my case, I want to have a quota applied to all the namespaces. So I create a resource quota defining a number of pods of CPU that should not be go above that, and a network policy specifying that only inbound connections from the same namespace are allowed, and the outbound connections are allowed only to inside the cluster and into this specific IP address that represent a backend system where my application needs to connect. So saying that, I can stage my changes, I can apply these changes. I just configured this integration on VS Code. Let's see how this works, and I can commit this to create these namespaces. So this is basically, this represents a platform admin. Is the commit going? Yeah, this represents a platform admin actually creating the landing zones for applications. I prepared a command to see to do a kubectl get namespace for the kube context, for the GCP cluster and the EKS cluster, and just to see with the, to getting the namespace of type application to see if these namespaces are created. Oh, sorry, GCP cluster probably is not the right one because I called it GKE cluster. Okay. And this one is for the EKS cluster. Okay, so I applied, I need to push my configuration. And see if this happens. As I said, this is basically to configure landing zones for applications to provide a kind of access to a multi-tenant Kubernetes cluster, okay? So let's hope this happens soon. It was years that I didn't configure VS Code with the Windows subsystem for Linux. It works really well, but let's see. Okay, as you can see, namespaces started to appear here and will start to appear also on the EKS cluster. There is a polling interval. The default is about 20 seconds, but it's possible to tune this. Let's now try to represent the workflow of a user that needs to actually deploy the application. And here you can see also on the EKS. So let's pretend I'm Leonardo. I have access only to my specific namespace. I try to deploy an application, HTTPB in a simple server test application. I try to do this on my dedicated namespace. I can do that. If I try to do this on the namespace of the other application team, I have errors because I'm not authorized to do that. If I try to see the application namespace configuration of the application one namespace, as you can see, I have applied these resource quotas where I have a maximum of 2 CPU. I'm already using an alpha CPU. So if I try to deploy a pod that will go above that, I should have an error, no? So I cannot go outside the boundaries of what the platform admin allow it to me. If I try to do the same with the other user, this is Windows. With the other user, if I try to do the same from Michelangelo, on I have, as you see, I have browser windows logged with the users. If I try to do with Michelangelo on application one, I should have the opposite approach. So I'm not authorized to do that. If I go in my dedicated namespace, I can create my application. I can deploy my application. Let's try also to deploy another test application, a client application, to try to do some connection, sleep.yaml, and let's try to execute let's try to do in this way on my namespace, go to the sleep application and try to execute some commands. Okay, maybe two of these. Okay, here if I try to connect to HTTP beam, on my namespace, on the port 8000, live demos are always fun. Okay, I got an answer. This is an endpoint just printing the headers of the request. If I try to do the same on the application one namespace, I get no response back. I get no reply. Why this happens? This happens because I have this network policy applied. Okay. It's this NS isolation network policy that, as we recall, avoid block all connection from that come from other namespaces. As you can see, network policy is here. If the Leonardo try to delete that, he cannot do that because this is centrally managed. So what can be done? One thing that can be done is to, as we said, try to apply some of the approach related to the source code management approach. So Michelangelo could fork. Let me see if I have the Zoom monitor. Okay. Michelangelo can try to fork the configuration repository. In that case, in his own account, this is just to show, and make a local copy of it. Okay. and create a new branch and work in this branch to work on the network policy. So change the network policy to try to request the network connectivity he needs. So let's see if we can change this to something that could work for him. Okay, let's try to copy that in order to try to allow traffic at least from other application namespace. So I have ingress allowed only for the same pods. And let's try to add this namespace selector also to the ingress. Okay. And have this push. Now Michelangelo could open a pull request to the main repository to ask for this permission. It's like the GitOps way could be of requesting a network firewall rule, no? In my account, myself, pretending to be the platform admin or the security admin, I can review this pull request, review the files changed, and see, okay, they want to allow the application in space to have connectivity each other. This doesn't seem reasonable. I can merge this pull request. And I should see that this will be a new commit and this should produce an update of the network policy. I should be able to see that. Oh, sorry. With that. With the scribe of the network policy, I see that I have this 435B19 commit. Is the same. So this should be applied. So in this case, if Michelangelo try again, to connect to the application one, he should be able to connect. So there is a flow where this has been implemented. Saying that, and back to the slide quickly, there are other two components. I don't have time to go in deep in this, but you can find documentation about that, and I will hang in the Slack channel to answer this. The other one is policy controller, that besides centrally configuring Kubernetes resources, it is an admission webhook based on Open Policy Agent Gatekeeper that evaluate all requests done on the API server, on Kubernetes API server to enforce central defined policy, and Config Connector that is a connector that allow you to configure non-Kubernetes resources with a Kubernetes resource model. And with this, I finished. I hope I stayed on time. I don't think we have time, if I understood correctly, for question and answer here, but I will hang out in the Slack channel if you want to ask questions. Thanks a lot.